jumble sale from half a century ago. What makes it unusual is the woman serving behind the counter. Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, queen of dominions that comprised more than a tenth of the world's population. At one level, it's just rare footage of a light-hearted day, but it's also a touching reminder of a solemn promise the Queen made as a young woman of 21.
I declare before you all that my whole life, whether it be long or short, shall be devoted to your service and the service of our great imperial family to which we all belong. But I shall not have the strength to carry out this resolution alone unless you join in it with me, as I now invite you to do. I know that your support will be unfailingly given. God help me to make good my vow, and God bless all of you who are willing to share in it.
This is the personal story of Elizabeth II and her relationship with her people during her 50 years on the throne. That special bond has needed constant renewal through a period of extraordinary change, sometimes even crisis. Above all else, the Queen knows that the monarchy depends on the consent of the people. Elizabeth was still a princess when, in January 1952, she set off with her husband for a long tour of the Commonwealth. Her father, King George VI, had been ill, but he came to wave goodbye.
He stood at the end of the runway. His face is etched on my mind. It was the face of an ill man, determined to do his duty.
The Princess and the Duke of Edinburgh were expecting to be away for 5 months. First stop was Kenya, then still a British colony. After official engagements in Nairobi, the plan was to spend a few days in the bush, fishing and watching the wildlife. The highlight was a night at Treetops, a house built in a large fig tree, a perfect vantage point at dusk.
It was just what the princess loved, because she had her big cine camera and she was able to film all these elephants. And it was the most perfect night you could imagine.
But it was also the night that would change her life forever. At 9 a.m, a Buckingham Palace official drove to 10 Downing Street with an urgent message for the Prime Minister. He was shown into Winston Churchill's bedroom.
I walked in and I said to him, "Prime Minister, I have bad news for you. The King has died. I know no details." And Churchill just sort of flopped on the bed. It was strewn with papers, and he just said, "Bad news, the worst." And he threw the papers aside and said, "How unimportant these matters seem now."
The royal couple had now moved on to a lodge the colonial government had given them as a wedding present. London tried to get through to the princess to tell her she was now queen. But international communications were difficult, and so everyone else heard first.
"This is London. It was announced from Sandringham at 10:45 today that the King passed peacefully away in his sleep earlier this morning."
But the one place no one was listening was Sagana Lodge. Elizabeth was actually writing to her father about her magical night at Treetops when the phone rang. The Duke was asleep. His private secretary took the call. There was a rumor the King had died. He closed the door so that Elizabeth couldn't hear and turned on the wireless. A tolling bell confirmed the worst. He woke the Duke. Philip took his wife into the garden and broke the news.
As soon as we saw the princess, we could tell something was wrong. She looked very sad, very different from the way she'd previously looked.
As always, she was quite extraordinary. Obviously terribly shocked, very, very white. You know, the first thing you think of is that her father's dead, and she adored her father. So I remember forgetting to curtsy completely, but going up and giving her a hug. And she just said, well, I'm so sorry, it means we've all got to go back. And so then one suddenly thought, my God, of course, I mean, it's the king, you know.
After a while, the policeman who came with her started packing her bags and preparing to leave. That's when we realized that the king must have died.
The new queen headed for the nearest airfield. From there, she would have to fly to Entebbe in Uganda to pick up a larger aircraft for the long flight home.
The extraordinary thing was that all along the way, when one passed groups of mud huts and then big villages, all the Africans came out and they just stood there with their heads bowed. And whenever there was a group of photographers, they had their cameras at their feet and just stood there, completely silent. Nowadays, one realizes what an impressive gesture that was.
But a tropical storm blew up at Entebbe. The pilot said it was too dangerous to take off.
Wasn't taking any chances. I had a queen now, not the princess. So I delayed, I suppose, for about an hour, which was very frustrating, of course, for everybody in London, bleating all the time about why haven't you left?
At London Airport, Winston Churchill waited to greet his new queen. It was now some 30 hours since the king's death had been announced.
We were looking out of the aircraft window. And she says, oh, they've sent the hearses, meaning the big royal limousines. And when she said that, one thought, oh, my God, to think this young woman of 25 and her husband and two small children, it's the end of their private life.
And consent of tongue and heart, publish and proclaim that the high and mighty princess
Elizabeth Alexandra Mary is now, by the death of our late sovereign of happy memory, become Queen Elizabeth II,
with long and happy years to reign over us. God save the Queen.
God save the Queen.
God save the Queen.
The Queen's first task was to lead the country in mourning for her father. Just as they were to do 50 years later for the Queen Mother, hundreds of thousands queued to pay tribute to him.
It so happened that on the day of the King's funeral, we had arranged to move house, and of course that couldn't be put off. The removal men had their radio switched on, as we did ours, and we were all listening rather solemnly.
The late, most high, most mighty, and most excellent monarch.
And I remember at one point in the service, and I've never forgotten it, the two removal men who were dressed in their overalls stood on the doorstep, listening to the radio, and they quietly took their caps off. They were both wearing cloth caps, doffed their caps, and stood and listened silently and motionlessly for a minute before they resumed moving the furniture again.
The ceremonial at Buckingham Palace has barely changed since I used to come here as a small boy in the early 1950s. But almost everything else is completely different. Indeed, the country we live in now seems only distantly related to the one which Elizabeth II inherited.
It was a time of hardiness and hope. We'd begun to build a welfare state, but we were still struggling to pay for victory in the war. Tea, eggs, sweets, and butter were still rationed. Pleasures were simple. Money was short. Into those grey days burst a glamorous new queen who symbolized renewal. People talked of the dawn of a new Elizabethan age. Coronation Day turned out to be cold and wet, but the country responded with the biggest street party since the end of the war. 2 million people lined the streets of London that June day. What made this coronation a national event was a new device called television. People crowded round every available set to share the Queen's big day in flickering black and white.
And here comes Her Majesty, Queen Elizabeth II. By the grace of God, Queen of this realm and of her other realms and territories, head of the Commonwealth, defender of the faith. So she goes on her way towards Westminster.
If you had a television, you know, everybody came in to see it. But my mum made a buffet and there was the roast ham and the peas pudding and the beef. And the cakes and the custard pies, and you watch the ceremony enthralled.
And at last the coach for which all eyes have been waiting.
My family bought a television, the first we had ever had. The neighbours poured in, the room was absolutely packed, and my main responsibility as a 10-year-old was to make the tea and keep bringing it in.
They've seen the Queen on her coronation day.
Nobody said anything, only, oh, look at this, and isn't she beautiful, look at it. We all got stiff necks and things because we were all sitting, children and grown-ups, nobody could move.
And such a burst of loving cheering from these children. As
my grandfather, he produced us a big bottle of whiskey that he bought special for the occasion. And all the adults got a wee drop of the hard stuff to toast the new queen.
And now, here comes Her Majesty.
When the Queen arrived at Westminster Abbey, her 6 maids of honour helped her out of the coach, ready to carry her 20-foot-long train.
Once we got the train and everything's arranged, she just looked behind her and said, "All right, girls," and off we went.
She looked young and simple, as a young woman would, you know, perhaps slightly overcome by the nature of the ceremony that she was undertaking.
It was out of this world. The Queen was so beautiful. We all wanted to be like her.
The things which I have here before promised, I will perform and keep, so help me God.
I feel somehow the fact that she was so young, if she'd been a middle-aged person being crowned, it wouldn't have been nearly so moving.
And the Archbishop then anointed her with oil and put a cross on her forehead. And we all, at least I did, had a prayer for her. I prayed that her reign would be a long and happy one.
When the Queen was crowned, everybody in the room stood up to attention.
When the crown was actually put on her head, everybody cheered and said, "We've got a new queen, we've got a new queen." My granny burst into tears.
In that very moment, I think, the whole weight of the country was on her, the weight of a nation. She realized maybe it will be a difficult life for her, but she did it. It was very moving.
We had decided to splash out on buying a seat in Parliament Square. So we were there when the Queen came out, fully crowned and in her royal coach. And I've never forgotten it.
Excitement spilled over into streets and town squares across Britain. In the 50 years since then, the fairy tale romance of the coronation has given way to something more practical. The rigid barriers of the class system have largely broken down, and the monarchy is no longer treated with the same reverence. But there is still a bond between queen and country.
To be honest with you, you just do not, you know, say you like the queen. You do not say you respect the queen. You just do not say you've got any positive feeling towards them at all. But if she was to come into your hometown or your street or your school or wherever you lived, you would go down there straight in, straight out, so no one spots you, but you would be there just so you could say you did see the Queen.
I've just seen her mature the way we all have, but with such dignity and such dedication. I just want to be part of the crowd and show us some sort of loyalty, because I think she needs an awful lot of reassuring.
There was a time when the Queen could have taken such reassurance for granted. How things have changed. In the early days of her reign, the young queen was above criticism. So it was a shock in 1957 when a Conservative peer, Lord Altrincham, attacked her Tweedy entourage and said that her speeches made her seem like a priggish schoolgirl. His criticism caused a storm.
I mean, to judge from your article, you expect the Queen to have qualities of a wit. You would like her to be a better orator. You would like her to be a TV personality, in addition to being a diligent, dutiful and devoted monarch and a mother.
What I'm suggesting is that in her public speeches and appearances, spontaneity should be the keynote. There are obviously certain speeches which have to be rather carefully prepared and which are, of their very nature, rather ceremonial. But I think that most of her speeches would greatly benefit from being more natural.
The famous phrase, I suppose, that jumped out of the page at people was that her speeches were a pain in the neck.
Yes. I thought no harm in being quite blunt about that.
Well, that's pretty offensive, isn't it? Not just blunt.
But I've never criticised her voice, as some people still think I did. What I was criticising was the content of her speeches, quite unsuited to the character of a young and inexperienced woman.
I have vivid memories of my visits during my father's lifetime to Commonwealth parliaments overseas.
They were the speeches of an elderly high priest, and she was talking down from a great height.
My forthcoming journey.
One man took such offence at Altrincham's remarks that he accosted him as he left the television studio.
I'm happy to say I didn't actually fall to the ground, which I would have been rather ashamed if I'd actually been knocked down. But it was quite painful.
The man was Mr. Philip Burbage, a member of the League of Empire Loyalists.
Mr. Burbage, why did you do it?
I didn't enjoy it quite inasmuch as those things are foreign to my nature, but I felt that something had to be done about it. I realised that Prince Philip could not do it himself or any other member of the royal family.
Today, such attitudes are dead. When the British table tennis team joined their Paralympic colleagues at a royal reception, there was easy familiarity on both sides.
They're awfully heavy, aren't they?
Yeah, they do weigh a bit. You feel as though you'll achieve something when you
put
them. Solid.
Nice, aren't they?
Fantastic. One of the best nights that I've ever had in my life. A smashing lady. Honestly, just like my mum. She was talking to me like I'm talking to you, as if we're at the pub, me and the lads.
Have you ever played table tennis?
I've tried.
Any good?
I can't do the sort of things you do, no.
I'll have to coach you. Is that okay?
I don't think my brain works quick enough to do that. It's the speed of it.
You don't need a brain. He hasn't got one.
When I touched her on the shoulder, the team manager and the wheelchair players, the disabled players, they were like this, as if to say, what have you done? But she didn't bat an eyelid. She just carried on talking as if I hadn't done anything. Didn't mean to do it, sorry, Queen.
I'll give you some anticipation practices if you want. Would you like that?
Before I went, the Queen didn't really mean a lot to me. She's rich, she's powerful, that's it. But you don't actually realise how much work these royal people do. I mean, she met nearly every single person there. She loved it. You could tell she was big time into it.
Such light-hearted informality would have been unthinkable when she first came to the throne. The year of the Altrincham row was also the year her Christmas message went out on television for the first time.
My own family often gather round to watch television, as they are at this moment. And that is how I imagine you now. I very much hope that this new medium will make my Christmas message more personal and direct.
I remember every Christmas, Dad would have us pinned in front of the TV watching Queen's speech under duress.
On the dot, 3 o'clock, 3:05.
Oh, yeah.
On the dot.
You know,
it's like it's just some alarm clock he's got inside his body. He just automatically switches and there we go, Queen's speech, flick the channel and We're all just sat there. Listen.
It's inevitable that I should seem a rather remote figure to many of you. A successor to the kings and queens of history. Someone whose face may be familiar in newspapers and films, but who never really touches your personal lives. But now, at least for a few minutes, I welcome you to the peace of my own home.
Well, when we was at the Christmas eating our Christmas pudding and Christmas dinner and all that, when the national anthem came on, my dad always used to say, "Stand up, everybody stand up." And we all used to stand up until the age of about 12 or 13. And then obviously I've never done it since.
An irreverent television show in the 60s showed how attitudes to the monarchy were changing.
Oh, God, lover, sit down. It's a mark of respect, isn't it?
Oh, don't be daft, Dad.
It's a mark of respect to her, isn't it?
And him.
Not in front of the television set in your own home, though.
Listen, you traitorous scarce git. I got a bit of respect for Her Majesty, I have. She has to have her Christmas dinner late because of doing that speech. She has to go up to the BBC.
Well, they keep it warm for her,
though. Look, she has to go up to the BBC.
No, they put it in the oven for her.
And you ain't even got the respect of staying up for the hell of it.
Come on, mate. I mean, look, what does she do?
Huh? What does she do?
Yeah, I mean, what's she work at, eh?
The answer's clear, and it's been reassuringly the same year after year after year.
My lords and members of the House of Commons, I have great pleasure in declaring Gatwick Airport open.
My lords and members of the House of Commons, my lords and members of the House of Commons. My lords and members of the House of Commons.
My goodness, I've been busy.
Four times a year, the Queen is at home to her public. More than 40,000 guests are invited to her garden parties, three in London and one in Edinburgh. It's a way of recognising people who've given special service to their community. 100,000 cups of tea, 250,000 sandwiches and cakes, and for most of the guests, a first look at the Queen close up.
Some people said to me, "Oh my God, there she's coming, she's coming." Actually, Her Majesty, her presence is so powerful when you're actually near her. There's something magical about her. I don't know, I can't describe it.
To me, the Queen was a figurehead, you know, just a name. But to actually see her walking amongst the crowds, I'm looking at her dress and I'm thinking, hang on, she's a woman. She's just a normal woman.
Majesty, may I introduce Mr. and Mrs. Phipps?
Please meet you, Majesty.
Daughter Shelley.
Please meet you.
From Swindon. And Mr. Phipps is the doorkeeper in House North.
Oh.
Yes, ma'am. I was on the doors as you entered for the state opening of Parliament. There was a young lady there, and it was the first time she'd ever done it. She was quite nervous.
So you have lady doorkeepers?
Yes, we have three. And there's two that actually work on the floor of the house.
Mm-hmm.
You raised a smile there, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes. No, they fitted in very well as well.
Absolutely.
She is, to me, someone who you love and someone who, you know, you look at her, and I think she is very sincere the way she will talk to you and ask maybe questions and then answer you where she will listen.
And
What do you do?
I'm a hairdresser.
Hairdresser?
Yeah.
Oh, really? Oh,
wow. My boss was trying to persuade me to bring a card along today, but I said I don't think that's quite appropriate.
Nobody, on meeting the Queen face to face, fails to be moved.
Thank you very much.
And the romantic idea of having a head of state in whom the blood of the first Elizabeth, Henry VIII, and other monarchs runs, I think is of the essence of the system. In the 1960s, Britain was loosening up. You really got me going. The question was whether the monarchy should or could do the same. The Beatles might have claimed to have smoked pot inside Buckingham Palace, but most royal rituals went on unchanged. Formal handshakes with dignitaries, no small talk with the adoring public, in fact, no sound at all, and nobody to get too near.
If the camera edges too close, the royal detective places himself between it and the Queen.
But some in the palace began to worry that they were losing touch with the people.
When you see her on the television, she seems to be miserable.
Tense.
Mm-hmm.
Miserable.
And tense, yeah.
Yes.
Would she come out on the balcony or something so that we could have all seen her? Yes, I mean, we could have seen her all. I mean, she just didn't turn round at the steps.
She didn't notice us at all. When we might not have been here.
The palace turned to television to help the public to get to know their queen. For the first time, cameras were given special access for a whole year. The film Royal Family was a phenomenon.
First time that we'd really heard them talk to one another rather than addressing us.
Well, you realise this is guaranteed failure.
Absolute total guaranteed failure.
I don't quite know how to put this, but I never liked the idea of the Royal Family film. I always thought it was a rotten idea. The attention that had been brought on one ever since one was a child, you just didn't want any more. I mean, the last thing you needed was greater.
I think it was a mistake ever to agree to make that film. We all knew the Queen's not like us lesser mortals, but when I was a kid, nobody wanted to know those things. That was the Queen's private life. She had very little private life to begin with, so what she had, she was entitled to keep.
James.
Oh, why is it on there?
Same at all.
Oh, I love it.
I thought it was a delightful programme. A great many of us hadn't necessarily seen her in the role of a mother and a wife, we saw her as head of the state.
The following year, the palace brought the Queen into more direct contact with ordinary people. The trial run took place in Wellington, New Zealand, where to the crowd's surprise, the Queen's car stopped and she carried out her very first walkabout. The Queen and Prince Philip had, in this way, managed to meet and have direct contact, even if only fleetingly, with an enormous number of people, and this was a great innovation. Princess Anne and Prince Charles were with their parents. It was one of their first tours together.
We were new at it, so we were introduced from day one into the concept of the walking about. And I think for the Queen it was probably more difficult because it was an... But on the other hand, it was an extended process of something that they already did, very much like a street garden party.
Did you find it fun?
No. You wouldn't, would you?
Well, you might... Fine, it's not...
A 19-year-old suddenly being dropped in the middle of a street and told to go and pick on somebody and go and talk to them. Fun? No, I don't think so. A challenge.
Part the waters and...
Get in all right up that amazing ramp that has been built.
The shingle or gravel, that was a bit tricky. I had to come in there.
It's horrid out there, isn't it? It's quite deep.
When her face lights up in a smile, it's electric. But it used to be particularly rather rare.
Very nice to see you here.
Yeah, thank you.
I do expect she's found it all that easy, these public performances, like anyone would find it difficult. And I think that as the years have gone by, she's become much more relaxed. I feel she's more like the Queen Mother always was. But then the Queen Mother was never the monarch.
shooting it. The basketball was fairly dangerous in a wheelchair, but that must be even more dangerous. God save the Queen!
As the Queen came up to her 25th year on the throne, pop culture was becoming more anti-establishment, and Britain was in economic crisis. Not the ideal setting for celebrating her silver jubilee. But in the event, the nation surprised itself by its own enthusiasm. The Queen went to Windsor to light the first in a chain of beacons across her kingdom and was caught up in the spirit of the occasion.
I had a major in the Royal Signals who should be nameless, who was up a tree with a button. And when he saw the flame get to the bonfire, he was going to press the button and the bonfire would light because of all the electrical pyrotechnics inside. Well, the Queen lit the beginning of the touch paper. And it went, like that. And he thought, oh, that's it, and he pressed the buttons. So as her flame was sort of quietly going along the ground, the fire lit. Which is a slight pity. I think she said to me, I can't imagine why you asked me. We all sat laughing at this thing as the sort of flame went along the ground. And the fire, by the time I got to the fire was well away. I mean, it was roaring. I said, Your Majesty, I'm afraid to say absolutely everything could go wrong is going wrong. And she turned to me and smiled and said, good, what fun.
Three cheers for Her Majesty the Queen. Hip hip!
Celebrate you, baby. I have to praise you like I should.
It was like winding the clock back to Coronation Day. But this time, the Queen was not a distant figure. She was much more among the people.
We had most of the windows down, and you could hear the roar and the comment. And they all thought that when she looked at them, she was looking at one particular person, you know, looking at them, you could hear it. She was looking at me, they were saying, you know. She was looking at me, you know, and that made their day.
The Queen was absolutely bowled over by the expressions of love and welcome that she received all over the country. She's a very humble person, and she found it amazing that people should respect her so much and be so fond of her. And that really affected her very deeply.
It was so joyous. It seemed to draw people together.
The anniversary briefly rekindled the sense of community that had been lost in the economic strife and disappointments of the 70s. Jubilee's climax was a Thanksgiving service in St. Paul's Cathedral. Afterwards, the Queen returned to the vow to serve her people that she'd made when she was 21.
Although that vow was made in my salad days when I was green in judgment, I do not regret nor retract one word of it.
Fifteen years later, the jubilation seemed a distant dream. The blaze at Windsor Castle in November 1992 symbolised the difficulties engulfing the House of Windsor.
Seeing these flames leaping into the sky was just horrific and frightening. There was one moment, I think, when one did think that the whole place was going to go on fire.
The royal family was under siege because of its cost and the lifestyles of its junior members. Worst of all, the marriages of three of the Queen's children were failing, painfully and in public. And now this.
It was the most terrible thing to watch. But as you would expect, she was stoic. She doesn't like to show her emotions. But that's not the way she is. And I understand that.
I can remember the Queen being stood in the middle of the courtyard and I could see how upset she was. And I would have loved to have gone up and said, you know, never mind, and put my arm around her. But you know darn well that you can't. So this poor woman is stood there watching her home go up. And all of us are feeling what she must be going through. And obviously wanted to comfort her, but no one had the courage to go and do it. Although this woman's very powerful and much loved, it must be a very lonely sort of position to be in.
By now, she'd served 40 years on the throne. But when the government suggested the repairs should be paid for from public funds, there was a storm of protest in the media.
I have to admit, I completely misjudged the way people would react. I was astonished at the press campaign. Windsor Castle belongs to the Queen, therefore she should pay for it. Well, I suppose in a sense, Windsor Castle belongs to the Queen, of course it does. But the Queen can't dispose of it, she can't sell it. And I thought, it was a very miserable and mealy-mouthed response. It just seemed so mean-spirited and out of character for the British nation.
Just 4 days later, in a remarkably personal speech to the City of London, the Queen acknowledged both the public mood and her own pain.
No institution, city, monarchy, whatever, should expect to be free from the scrutiny of those who give it their loyalty and support, not to mention those who don't. And that scrutiny can be just as effective if it is made with a touch of gentleness, good humour, and understanding.
It was taken that it was rather an emotional speech. In some ways, the circumstances were emotional, but the catch in the Queen's voice was actually more to do with a sore throat.
1992 is not a year on which I shall look back with undiluted pleasure. In the words of one of my more sympathetic correspondents, it has turned out to be an annus horribilis.
The Latin phrase came from one of her former courtiers. He'd written to commiserate over the way her 40th year on the throne was turning out.
As a classical scholar, I ought to have known that if I wanted to say what a horrid year, it would be really annus horrendus rather than annus horribilis, which would mean a year that was capable of scaring you, which perhaps not quite the same meaning.
Actually, the next few years were rather scary. As a palace official said to me, it was one thing after another. The breakdown in the Prince and Princess of Wales's marriage was played out in the newspapers day after day. Private phone calls were published. And then on television, each of them admitted adultery. Finally, they were divorced, as were the Duke and Duchess of York. And the Queen stuck to her routine, revealing very little in public.
She's a very strong woman. I think people perhaps don't realize quite how strong she is. And I think the way she behaved in those years saved the monarchy from far worse problems than otherwise they might have faced.
She seemed to upstage the Queen every time she appeared, and her agenda caught public imagination. Diana's death in a car crash in August 1997 caused what felt like a national nervous breakdown.
Although I'm not really a royalist, I really feel compelled to leave these flowers for her. I'm just completely shocked. It just sounds so absurd that, well, the best one of the lot had to go first.
The Queen stayed at Balmoral with Diana's two sons. In London, her courtiers struggled to grasp what was happening.
I did, on two occasions, walk around the crowd outside Buckingham Palace to try and understand the mood that existed amongst the public. I think the thing that, of course, impressed me most was the silence, which I found very worrying.
What concerned the palace most was that many of the mourners were bitter as well as tearful.
Everybody I spoke to felt that the Queen, Prince Philip, should be there. This was the place for him to be. When everybody was grieving, where were they?
The empty flagpole was taken as royal indifference. The protocol said it flew only the royal standard and only when the Queen was in residence. But the mourners said, damn the protocol, fly the Union Jack.
Clearly there was a great pressure to have the Union Jack flying at half mast. You can't fly the royal standard at half mast. It never flies at half mast. And I think, with the benefit of hindsight, we should have moved a bit earlier on this.
Belatedly, the palace complied with public demand, but it was now on the defensive. 4 days after Diana's death, the Queen and her family paused outside the gates of Balmoral to acknowledge public grief.
A death in a family is bad enough, but when you're expected to grieve, for the whole of the nation, it becomes impossible. And I personally did feel sorry for her.
I know from the conversations I had during that week that the absolute and total concentration of the royal family was on the children and what was best for them, and that really is what a family should do in those circumstances.
When the Queen finally came to London on the eve of Diana's funeral, her officials were nervous of the reception she'd get. But she seized the initiative and disarmed her critics.
It looks as though the Queen is about to, she's getting out of the car and is going to talk to people.
It's extremely unusual. This is almost unprecedented.
She spoke to a few people. I was one of those people. And I just said how sorry I was for what had happened, and that that William and Harry were now her main concern, and that she must take great care of them. And she said she would, And she said it was so hard for them because they were so young and because they loved their mother so much.
Normally cautious, the Queen now gambled again. After talking to the crowd, she spoke live to the nation.
What I say to you now, as your Queen and as a grandmother, I say from my heart. First, I want to pay tribute to Diana myself. She was an exceptional and gifted human being.
It stabilised the situation. It's one of the very best speeches she's made in her reign, in my opinion.
Diana's funeral the following day brought that extraordinary week to a close. To some, the changes in British society during the reign had been starkly revealed.
What it says to me is that we are a secular society which is ready to worship any temporary gods who may appear, or goddesses. And I think it is the absence of a deep religious feeling in this country at the present time that we are ready to turn to celebrities, to pop stars, and it's all very transient and passing.
But the Queen now caught the mood. Tradition was set aside.
There were two events that took us completely by surprise. First of all, we noticed a car driving out of Buckingham Palace with Prince Philip in it, and it turned out that he was going across to St. James's to join in the cortege going to the Abbey. And then, as the funeral procession came by, the Queen led the other members of the royal family out, and they paid their respects as the coffin passed by. And those two decisions that were only taken that morning showed that already there was a readiness to be more flexible.
In a different crisis 4 years later, that flexibility was evident from the start. After the terrorist attack on the World Trade Center, the Queen broke off her annual holiday to attend the memorial service in London. And in a unique gesture of understanding, the band at Buckingham Palace played the American national anthem.
I believe I knew her well enough to know that she actually thought of it herself and told him to do it. It took my breath away. It was wonderful.
I think the Queen's now learnt to be more open, more human, to get all her emotions across.
It is something I will never forget for as long as I live.
This Jubilee year has already proved to be unexpectedly emotional for the Queen, with the deaths of her sister and then her mother. At the ceremonies for the Queen Mother, the bond between Queen and country had clearly been reinforced. She said the applause from the crowds was one of the most moving responses she'd ever experienced. With the reassuring rhythm of royal duties, the Queen has presided over a peaceful revolution. She serves her people by being the one fixed point in a changing age.
The Queen has shown amazing stability and steadiness of character through a period of great flux. And I think even though people don't sort of go around throwing their hats in the air and saying how marvelous she is, I think they feel it. Because that sort of steadiness in the times that we've lived through has been really precious.
Obviously, she has changed, but I think she's going with the times. And she had a very hard life, I think. As a woman, a mother, head of state, head of church, I don't know. I don't think many people could do it. I think she has a calling, a real calling.
I think there will come a time when we'll have a monarch who will be more relaxed, both in public and in private. But that's her style, that's the way she's done it. And who's to argue that there's a better way? She seems to me to be pretty successful at it.
Last year, in fact, we were holding in Malaysia and we were held armed hostage for 45 minutes.
Fairly unpleasant.
Indeed.
Hope we won't find that round here.
I love the lady, and I think she has served the nation remarkably well, and do pray and hope that she lives a long life like the mother.
Next week, more personal and revealing home movie footage of life within the royal family. Queen and Country continues next Wednesday at 9 here on BBC One.